Oh, my name is Debbie Allen, and I am the host of Access to Experts. My guest today is someone you're going to really want to listen to every word because you're going to bring brilliance into your life, brilliance and bankroll your ideas, your passion, something that I'm definitely interested in learning more about too. And I've been waiting quite a while to have this special guest on my show. So let me give her a formal introduction to you. Her name is Nicole Roberts-Jones, and she's uniquely gifted at one thing, and that's drawing out the very best in you and helping you take the brilliance to the bank. She's a veteran entertainment industry. Nicole's worked in the talent management and casting before shifting her talents to become the founder and CEO of NRJ Enterprises. She now works with entrepreneurs and helping them create multiple income streams like I do. And then she already knows how to get them from going from an idea to an enterprise. And that's the thing. I think that the reason I wanted to connect with Nicole is that when you have that kind of intuitiveness, it doesn't just happen overnight. Business intuitive. It happens from years and decades of being in the business and being able to shift and pivot so many different times that you can almost, I call it intuitive, she'll call it brilliance. In addition to all of that, Nicole has worked with corporations, including executives, middle managers, pushing them to the internal edge and stepping them into true power with their gifts and their talents at work. Her clients include Steve Harvey, World Group, love him, Dell, McDonald's, Blue Cross, Blue Shield, and Lisa Nichols Group, Motivating the Masses, goes on and on. Listen, go, you get the idea. She is a true expert in what she does. She's also recognized as a transformational leader, bankroll your brilliance expert. And I'm sure she's the only one that coins that phrase, bankroll to brilliance expert. Trademark, yeah, dang. Best-selling author, 4 books, most recently being Find Your Fierce, which I love that title. She lives in Boston. And so here, I'm in Phoenix, she's in Boston, and we're now here together here on the podcast. Glad you're listening. Welcome, Nicole, to the show.
Excited to be here with you, Debbie. Excited to be here. If I say have you, no, you're having me. Yeah, I'm excited to be here.
Yeah, it's like as an expert, we do both, right, on the show and that. So tell me what inspires you to come up with the idea of the brilliance to bankroll? Like, was it coming up with people coming to you with ideas and saying, how do I make money from this?
You know, to be honest with you, I didn't ever set out to do this, right? So, and first of all, I'm transparent. So I've been doing this now 28 years, even though I'm still 29, right?
Yes.
But literally it happened in a moment where I had the job I've always dreamed about. You read my bio, so I worked in entertainment. It was a job I've dreamed of since I was 7 years old. Loved every minute of it. And yet I felt like something was missing, which I thought was super weird, because how can I love this thing? How could this be the thing I've dreamed of and still feel like something is off? So it was in the middle of that, that I began to ask myself questions and what I call finding my fierce, right? And so fierce is my word for purpose on fire, because I feel like purpose is so overused. And really it came from a time of me doing some soul searching. So that's really how I started in this work. I started to do a couple of things. Number one, really look at what is this thing that I do that lights up my soul? And so it was that journey that led me to get clear on what my brilliance is and how to begin to create multiple streams of revenue from it. That's kind of how it started. So if I give you more context to fierce, just so I say this, because I don't want to leave it out there. And people are like, well, what is she talking about? So I've been doing this work for probably about 10 years. And I was watching Beyonce one day on TV. And I would say I was hating her a little bit, but I'd be lying. I was She's having a full on yeah, this moment. Right. So, you know, she came up with Sasha Fierce at a time when she was being called to pivot in her own career. So up until that point, she had been on stage with other women in Destiny's Child. And now she had an opportunity to grow, which would be becoming a solo artist. And that scared her. And so in order for her to do this thing she knew she was meant to do, she conjured up this alter ego called Sasha Fierce, so that she could do this thing and be this thing and not let fear stop her. So in the middle of me watching this whole moment, what dropped in my spirit one day as I was watching Beyonce is, you have fierce too. So first I'm like, I know this is not you, God, talking to me while I'm watching Beyonce, right? But what I began to realize is, if we each stand in the full power of this thing that we're brilliant at, that we're great at, then we too will have that fierce going inside of us. And so that's really kind of how this party got started, when I had that big epiphany, and the rest is history.
Wow, that's incredible. Yeah, I love the title, Find Your Fierce, because it's just another way of, like, you know, finding your power, finding your brilliance, like you said. And that's, you know, that's really what makes people stand out. And so, you know, I'm sure people could, you know, they come with you with an idea and it's like, you can take an idea, but if it's not fierce, if you're not like going through challenges and just going to say, I'm not going to give up. You know, that's the key to really making it work. And here on the podcast, it's like, you know, we talk about being experts, and experts have gone through things. They have gone through the other side of it so many times that now they can transfer their information onto other people. Right. And that's really what makes an expert. It's like, I've done the work. You know, you're 10 steps ahead of somebody else that says, I can do this. And so if you look at this, you know, you're fierce. How did you find your fierce, Nicole?
So when I finally had that epiphany moment that I too have fierce, I realized, so for me, actually in this book, there's a picture of me at three. Okay. So at 3 years old, I am talking. My husband did a roast for my 40th birthday. Obviously I'm over 40, y'all. I'm over 50. So my husband, just so I can let that go. Right. So my husband did a roast for my 40th birthday. And when he and my mom were doing this behind my back, he looked at all these pictures of me and I was talking. Every single picture I'm talking and I'm, hello, what do I do for a living? I talk, right? Number one. Number two, at three, I have a baby carriage. There's no baby in that baby carriage, Debbie. There's no baby. There's paper and books. So first of all, I don't have children of my own. I have wonderful bonus children, but I have not birthed a baby, right? So I guess I knew that at three.
We have that in common. Yes.
Right. Then second, papers and books. See, I've always been a natural producer. So when I worked in entertainment, I worked in casting. And so as a casting associate, I wasn't yet a director, I was a casting associate. I put the right person in the right role. What do I do now? I put the right person in the right role in their business so they can make money. So in other words, that's who I was at three. That's who I was in my previous industry. And again, that fierce to me was expanding my territory. It's really, and I love how you say this, an expert has expertise, but it's not about the expertise, it's how do you grow it? So it would have been great for Beyonce to be just in Destiny's Child, but how does she grow her gift bigger? So it's that. It's taking the time to hire a coach to grow yourself, right? It's getting clear on how you take your gift to transform someone's life, because it's not about you, and then be able to package that to serve more and more people. So really, I've always been this person. I just finally recognized it and did the work to grow it.
So how did you start out, you know, working with people? It's like you got your first client, and then from there you got referrals, you started doing live events, learning to be a speaker. You know, how did your career transition? I love to hear that. Because people like to say, you know, okay, I see what she's doing. She's got some power. There's no doubt about it. But she started somewhere as far as like through the industry.
Look, it's level after level. I always say it's kind of like the school system where we matriculate level after level. So you go to kindergarten and then you go to first, you know, elementary, then you go to junior high, then high school. So you see me now and I'm probably about in maybe college of my career, but I didn't start here. Right. So when I had that moment where I felt like something was missing, and I kept, this is when I worked in entertainment again, just so you guys can keep up with all my flip flopping in my story. And I talked to all my girlfriends. They were like, are you crazy? Didn't we go to this premiere party? And didn't we go? Right. And so in the middle of me feeling dazed and confused, one of my girlfriends invited me to volunteer at a youth program with working with young women at our church. And when I started working with young women that night, as their eyes lit up, their heart lit up. Now, this was in 1993. There was no such thing as a coach yet. But for the first time in my life, my soul was alive. So I had a decision to make. And so what I realized now, some 28 years later, what I was doing was I was helping them get clear on what their purpose is. You know, when I talk to some of my girls now and they're in their 40s, I'm like, how old am I, right? But some of my girls I work with as teenage girls, they're like, Nicole, you've always been this purpose kind of catalyst, but I believe God had to start me there. And I did this alongside my business. So I didn't quit my entertainment career because I didn't know what this thing was. I did it as a volunteer. The more I did it, the more I loved it. And so I started trying to find a job doing this thing in the want ads. It was a paper because there was no internet then, y'all, right? Or at least I didn't have the internet yet. So looking through the want ads in a paper, everything I wanted to do that I thought was similar to this thing I was doing as a volunteer, which I now know is coaching. I thought it was called case management because I didn't know. Trying to find a job doing that. I needed an MSW. Didn't know what that was. So to make an even longer story short, I went back and got my master's degree in social work. That's what that is. So it was level by level. So continue to work with teenage girls. By the time I stopped doing that, I don't do that anymore. But I had 10 chapters in 10 states. That little program at my church became a nonprofit, a national nonprofit. So it was in the middle of that, Debbie, that one of my girls who now, my first sets of girls are grown women working in their careers, and now I'm coaching them one-on-one. One of them said, Nicole, you know you're my coach. Oh, she sent me an article to explain to me what I was doing. So I started getting clients from there. They started referring people. So over time, I realized I love this work more than I love my girls' work, but I don't think I'd be here had I not cut my teeth on working with teenage girls. So that's really how, you know, I matriculated from kindergarten to elementary, right? And so even in the shift, some 10 years in, so 17 years, by 2010, I had both a nonprofit and a for-profit. So I was still working with my girls, and then I had a for-profit coaching. So at the time in 2010, my first book, and I think I met you somewhere around there, Debbie, where my first book came out, Define Your Own Way. And I wrote that book because I couldn't take any more clients. I had a maxed out coaching client roster. Mm-hmm. So I figured I could still give the principles to women, and it raised money for my nonprofit. So that is when my speaking career began in 2010, because people started calling me to speak because I had this book.
Sure.
And so literally every weekend I was going to some entrepreneurial symposium, a women's empowerment event, but I want you guys to get this. My business had gotten to the place I dreamed of when I started, but I was only generating $13,000 a year from it.
So I'm sharing
that with you because literally it doesn't matter if you have expertise, if you don't know how to actually package it. And that was my problem. I had this gift. I had taken the time 17 years to grow it, but I hadn't stopped long enough to get the systems and the operations around it. So to make an even longer story, I hired a coach. And it was, and what a coach does, and I'm going to be quiet after this, but this is a long answer to your question. What a coach does is shows you your blind spots. So there were things I was doing that I didn't realize I was doing. Once I pulled all of that together with my coach, I literally went from 13,000 to over 200,000 within 6 months. And my business has been growing ever since. And so it was really getting clear and then hiring someone that could show me, because I was doing things and didn't realize I was doing them. So yeah, that's how I got it.
So many nuggets of information, so many alignments that we have too, you know, not growing up, not having children. And it's like wanting to do something for women. You know, I've been dabbling in trying to do something with women, but I just went on to the business world. Always fell in love with business, started out that way, became a speaker first, then an author, because I didn't think I could do the authorship, but you still are one or the other. But again, always the talker, you know, in the family, you know, throw me a word, I got a story I can create, you know. So interesting, pay attention to where you were as a child. Like that is your soul. You know, when you talked about the soul on fire, that was like, you know, I get that. It's like, what does that? So, you know, even though I built a career and, you know, built businesses and done all of this stuff, there was still a piece of me missing, which is that women's, you know, how do I help women? It's like, have the sisterhood. I've never had a sister, never had kids. It's like, you know, I think that part of us as experts, mentors, we want to help. That because, you know, it's just part of like, we want to create that community around us. That's just a nurturing thing, I think, for women. Then if you haven't had children, you find another way to nurture. So you know, I've been through quite a few different women's groups, and now I'm in a group called Powerful Women Today, and I lead the global development for that. And we've grown exponentially, you know, since I started doing that. But I grew it as like, almost like I kind of will volunteer. I kind of want to be involved, you know, and it's a lot of sweat equity to get it going. And, you know, I'm a piece of it when it gets going. But, you know, the part of it is every time I remind myself I'm here because the stories that women tell, and they have amazing stories. And I mean, you know, not victim stories. Like I was here and now I went here. And I mean, amazing. Okay. So now that's the thing. Like you hit it on the head, Nicole, is they don't know how to monetize that. You know, they've just kind of fallen into the next step. Where should I go? And they give back a little bit too much, don't value themselves to ask for enough money. And I am sure you see that in the women that you work with is that, and you know, men and women, there's men and women both that you know, take less than what they deserve. But I think women, for the most part, because we are nurturers, we'll take less. We undervalue ourselves. We'll pump up all our sisterhoods, but you know, we take less. So, you know, how do you help women get past that mindset? Because even though you're teaching them to make money, there's a lot of what you're talking about has to do with mindset. You had to go through that.
Yep. So first I had to help myself through it, right? And you just said it. So literally, I think what happens to many of us, so every morning I wake up, I'm Nicole on autopilot. So I don't wake up in the morning and say, I think I want to be Nicole today. Like I can't wake up and say, I think I want to be Debbie today. Yeah, that won't work. So because of that, there are things that I do that are intrinsic to my DNA. And when I say DNA, I mean distinct natural ability. So because of that, I discount it because it's easy for me. We overlook it. And so first I had to be clear that the things that I do are my God-given gifts and talents. And I had to stop discounting it. So what I mean by that is when people call you and say, can I run something past you? Sure, that's called a strategy session. Let me tell you how much that costs, right? So you got to be clear on two things. What's the expertise that you bring? And what value, well, three things. You've got to be clear on let me just walk you through this way. So I call it my fierce framework, and they're going to be even better for the people that are listening that have this problem. So one, the first step is, what are you passionate about? Like, what can you do hour upon hour? Many of you are doing it hour upon hour and you're not getting paid for it. That was me, right? So by the way, when I was making $13,000, oh, I was serving big and getting paid little, right? So the second thing it has to correlate with is, what are you proficient in? So you can't love it and not be good at it. And you can't be good at it and hate it, because who wants to not want to do what they do or hate it, right? So I've been there, I've had jobs, I've hated. The third thing, which is I think the most important, is what problem does it solve? Because ultimately it's not about you. It's about you being the answer to someone else's problem. So for me, I had to realize that I'm giving away the answer and I'm giving it away for free, right? Like my grandmother used to say, baby, why would they buy the cow when they get the milk for free? Hello, right? Same thing in your business. If you're giving away your intellectual property for free, why would anybody pay you? So you've got to be willing to say, I'm more than happy to help you. Let me show you what that looks like, right? And so I've had to learn how to do that where it doesn't feel like a sleazy sale, because, you know, that was my problem too, is I never wanted to sell because it felt sleazy. And then once you understand you are the answer and you can speak to the predictable result you're able to get someone to, then that's where profit, the last P, comes in. So how do you make multiple revenue streams from it? So I had to really, really stop second guessing myself, get clear on the transformation. That's what that coach helped me do. I think for many of us, we discount it because it comes easy for us. But just because it's easy for me doesn't mean it's easy for you, right? And then the other thing is, like, Debbie and I do similar things, but there'll be some women that will resonate with you, Debbie, and there'll be some people that resonate with me. There's enough people for all of us to serve. If 20 of us did the same thing, there's enough people for all of us to serve. So then you've got to not be worried about, oh, well, so-and-so does that. So what? So-and-so doesn't do it like me. Right. So I think it's imposter syndrome. I think it's worrying about other people and perception. Those three things are the biggest barriers to women really owning their brilliance and getting paid for it.
It's interesting you mentioned imposter syndrome. That came up on one of my last podcasts. And that's one, two words. They're actually two words, drive me absolutely nuts. I think it's a box people put themselves in for an excuse. It's an excuse box, right? Right. There's lots of those excuse boxes. Well, if I fit over here, I can just stay here because I can call myself this or say I have this. So yeah, it's like when you're ready to step up, you step up. And I know that, Nicole, you believe in your clients a lot of times before they believe in themselves. Right. And you can see the vision. Because I mean, I know when you have that intuitivism, you have that vision, you can see it and see where they're going. But you know, you can't force somebody to believe that they can do it. Even though you see it, even though you know the steps, you're going to say, hey, follow the breadcrumbs, do everything I tell you to do, and you're going to be successful. I mean, I was a clueless young gal, didn't know how to run my business. I just picked up those breadcrumbs and gobbled them up, and I did everything my coaches told me to do. And I would never have been the success I was in those businesses without following that lead. So you choose. You know, if you're listening to this right now, you're listening to Nicole. She's a very brilliant lady, a true expert, and she's done the work, been decades of experience. Is like, you know, you step up and you say, hey, I need somebody to help me. I need somebody that speaks my language and gets my vision. And I think that's the first step when somebody steps up to work with somebody like yourself or like myself, is to say, I'm inspired by them, but I also see that they get me, you know. And when I don't get them, I don't know if you're the same way. You probably are, because you're booked up. You have to turn people away. I call it the bless and release. You know, you can tell, right? If they even use those two words, imposter syndrome, anywhere in their language, I bless and release instantly. I don't even try and convince them otherwise. Like, I don't think you're a right fit for me. Go work for Nicole. No, I wouldn't do that to you.
No, it's fine. And it's fine, because if they're a good fit, and here's the thing. It's like dating. You know, you go on some good dates, you go on some bad dates. Now, when you're clear a guy is not a good fit, please don't go on the second date, right? The other thing is, and I say this all the time, when people think I'm going to build it and people will buy, that's a lie. I don't care how brilliant you are, just because you build a program does not automatically mean people are going to buy it. It's almost like dating analogy again. So when my husband and I went on our first date, if he would have brought my ring, my engagement ring, to our first date, I would have thought, this man is crazy. Please, I would have been calling one of my girlfriends, please come get me, right? But he dated me for a while. So you've got to let people see your value. So I think that's one of the biggest misnomers in our business, is that when I am talking to someone, if the relay is not working, listen, all money's not good money. So if I'm clear in the beginning, our conversation is difficult. Yeah, not sure this is a good fit. If I can refer you, I always do. But here's the thing. I don't want my friends in the industry to be mad at me. So I never refer somebody that's difficult. But if you're difficult with me, I'm not referring you, right?
That's a bad thing.
But if it's somebody that just doesn't need what I have to offer, and I know someone else that can fill that need, I'm going to refer.
Yeah, that's a good point about your husband. That's true. Like on my first date with my husband, it was like, I didn't even get the kiss. I'm like, am I got the friend card? Right. So maybe it's the same way with the coaching. Like, is she willing to work with her or not? Makes me want it more.
But then he asked you for a second date. And so you got to get to know each other. And because the coaching industry is so oversaturated now, right? When I started, there were very few. Now there, you can find a coach on every corner, dare I say, right? Virtual corner. So now people are getting to know you. Listen, when I ask people, when they hire me, I ask them how long they've been watching me. Some people will say a day. Some people will say 4 or 5 years.
Right.
Because, you know, it just, everybody's moving forward, and really their ability to invest in themselves, their belief in the power of investing in yourself. When you're hiring a coach, you're not investing in that coach, you're investing in you.
Most definitely.
And so that's, I think, the biggest piece is just letting people get to know you.
Well, and I think the key is, you know, I do my research, even have somebody like yourself on the podcast. It's like, you have a great reputation. You've been around a long time. People respect you. You do what you say you're going to do. We have the same core values. That's important because even you showing up here, it's like we relate. And then as I get to know you, I'm like, oh gosh, you know, we're like even more in common, you know, because the thing is that you said this, there's so many experts on every corner, people calling themselves experts, you know, I mean, I'm teaching this. So of course but the thing is that the piece that's really critical is to be ethical and honest and true and give what you say you're going to give. And then you give more than that. That's what really sets the majority of people apart, like yourself, like you deliver from your heart, from your passion, your soul, where, you know, some people just, they don't even deliver. That's all about the money. And I don't think they can call themselves experts. They say they are, but there's a big difference in that world. And they've kind
and
of
can I just add
it.
To that? Can Most I add to definitely. That? Because to me, there's a difference between selling and serving. I was on a clubhouse maybe about a month ago, and a woman asked me a question. She said, you know, I developed this program and I saw all these other people doing it and they were making money. So I thought, ooh, let me do it too. And I developed it and I'm not making any money. And her question was, how come? I said, because you're trying to sell instead of serve. Mm-hmm. When you're serving that need, when you're being the answer to a problem and not trying to sell someone, people will effortlessly hire you because they see you as the answer. When people feel sold by you, they're not buying. And I think the industry is oversaturated with sell instead of serve.
Yeah, that's key. I was actually taking notes the way you wrote that, where you were saying that, because I'm actually writing a book on, you know, sell big, but serve bigger, right? Because the whole idea of what you were just talking about is you can go out and sell big, make a lot of money, but if you're not covered on the other end, if your heart base isn't coming from the service to begin with, that it was, you know, key the way you said it, is that you come from like a service base. So an expert say, oh, you know, decades of experience, and then you're just going to see that you're going to sign up, or I'm going to push that on you. Pay attention. If you're listening to this podcast, you just got a huge lesson. If somebody's trying to push a sale on you, they want to sell you. And again, we don't want to be sold, but sometimes people want to be sold, Nicole, even when they know it's wrong. All the red flags come up. I had a client recently that invested with me, and she invested $200,000 before she worked with me. And she was so underserved and didn't get anywhere because she was in this room all hungry, right? They go to these events, or they're listening to a podcast, or they're listening to a masterclass online, and they're just hungry. I need the answer. Okay, let me throw some more money out there. And they're throwing money out like crazy, and they're not getting served. They're just getting sold.
That's,
you know, that's sad, because it's like, there are experts that do care from their heart to serve you. And that's what you have to pay attention to. And you had that from the beginning. You had that from the very beginning, because as anybody that was going to be a social worker is definitely someone that's service, right? Yeah, because you ain't going into that business for money, right?
Right.
It's all about, you know, teenagers and young ladies and social work. Like, so you have that heart. You can't take that away. right? Yeah. And there's some people, they can learn to sell and they can learn to be an expert, but they can't learn to have a heart. And, and that's a key piece. And that's going to keep you in this business forever. Yeah. And so let's talk about a heart story, Nicole. Tell me about a case study that somebody's near to your heart that you took them from here to here based on how you worked on their business, their brilliance to bankroll.
So many people. There's so many people. But I think the first person that comes to mind in this moment is Stephanie Michelle. So I met Stephanie. I have an annual event and I do it virtual. But when she came in the room, she told me she was a financial/life coach. And something in my spirit was like, that's not her. And mind you, I don't know this woman. So I'm trying not to say that's not you. Because how dare I say this?
Yeah. Right? You'd be like, sexy girl. Yeah.
Right. So I let her ask me a bunch of questions. I ask her, and then I finally say, something's off. Something's off. I said, and I need you to figure that out before you leave. And you should have seen the look on her face like, right? So to make a really long story short, what we began to uncover in those 2 days is she really wanted to be a stylist. And everything about her, ooh, stylist. If you ever meet Stephanie Michelle, and by the way, those of you that need a stylist, I don't get paid to say this, you need to look up the power of style because she is thebomb.com. But when you see her, she oozes style, right? And so what she told me was that perception was in her way. Her family said you shouldn't, friends said you shouldn't, So she had become a nurse and she was lucrative as a nurse and had jumped out as this coach. And she had negative $200 in her account when she came to that event. So to make a long story short, of course, we started working together. We developed her whole platform. She went from negative $200 and she told me this, I didn't make this up. The first year, her income increased 500%. And all I did, Debbie, was help her stand in her fears. I helped her get clear on who she already was, how to package it, and then to stop apologizing to people. Stop caring about everybody else's perception. This is your life. You've got to live your life, right? And so it was really giving her permission to do this thing that was already rumbling inside of her. And I can give countless other stories of other women, but I think her shift was so big because what most people do when you look at a stylist, especially, and she's Jamaican. So dare I say, when you have family that has migrated to this country, they want a better life for you, right? Quote unquote. And so they want you to do something, doctor, lawyer,
right, one of the corporate world
professions. Safe. Right.
Yeah. Safe.
Right. Safe. So she had become a nurse to be safe. But all along, she'd been sewing at night and all along, she had been doing little things. And so it really was giving her that mirror to really see herself, the journey she had already been in, and stop hiding from it.
I just love that.
Yeah.
I just love that. Oh, wow. And that's the key. That's what keeps us going is those case studies where we see them change. They have to change here.
Yeah.
And you can have all heart, right? You got to connect this together with this, and then you got to learn the way to serve other people and hold that value. I mean, there's a lot of little modalities you learn as an entrepreneur that people just think, oh, okay, I can quit a corporate job or quit being a nurse. And interesting, I've had a lot of clients who are nurses too. They're great students. They're great. They're very coachable, but they have to learn how to take off the nurse hat and put on an entrepreneurial hat. And I have teachers like that same way. It's like, I love to see somebody that has never thought like an entrepreneur be able to shift and pick up those traits as an entrepreneur. I think that's the hardest thing. You can't just say, I'm going to have my own business now. You have to do a lot of personal work. You have to change. You have to learn different skills and different traits that it's almost like there's this huge checklist that nobody really sees. Like you have to just jump in and then find the list as you go along,
Right.
Yeah. I wish there was an easy checklist. Like just learn these things. You got it now. Right. Yeah. You're an entrepreneur.
So even in the midst of me failing my business, I went and got an accelerated MBA because I thought that was going to help me. It didn't. So what's interesting is in this landscape of coaching, it's a whole different world, right? Mm-hmm. So I can know how to do budgets. I can learn I can do a business plan, right? But coaching is bigger than a business plan, right? And I can't go to a bank and get funding as a coach until I've been in business 5 to 10 years. You can't start a coaching business unless you have a friend at a bank, right? And so it's a whole different arena. And there is no checklist. And then even if there is, everyone's business is different. So what I mean by that is you can't leave out your secret sauce. If I give you another example quickly, Deborah Tillman, America's Super Nanny, I met her. She was already successful. So she had the opposite issue that I did. She was making money. Her problem was she didn't have any more bandwidth to serve any more clients. And she had tons of families coming to her, And so I told her, we've got to create a, what I call a blueprint. And she was like, well, no, I tailor the experience every time I work with a family. Okay.
Get over yourself. Yeah, get over yourself if you want to grow.
Now, I thought she was going to hang up on me and fire me in that moment because it was silent. But really what most people don't realize, like I said earlier, you are your autopilot. If we can take the time to systematize what you do, you can serve more people without you having to be present. So for her, it wasn't about making more money. It was about the transformation she was leaving behind because she hadn't gotten clear. She was on TV, she was successful, but she still hadn't done the work to get clear. So with that, she created what she calls the GPS Greater Parenting System. And now she has online programs, group programs, as well as her one-on-one. So
she really became that expert in what she did. She stepped out of one pair of shoes and put on another pair of shoes and took that next step. And that's the key, is that people don't understand that. That's the true entrepreneurial thought. It's like, how do you multiply yourself, you know, magnify yourself? You know, you need to build to grow or build to sell or both. And when we build a business, it's just us. It's often, you know, we leave legacy through books and everything else. But and we can't, we get to a point where then we get real busy. And that's one of the biggest problems that my clients do. Well, okay, I raise my fee again. And, you know, what do I do? I got too many clients. So raise your fee again. Then they come back. Well, raise your fee again. Okay, well, you know, get some other people working with you. Right. Systemize. Get better clients. Say no to the wrong ones. You're working too hard for them. You know, that bless and release comes up again, you know? And so every day you get up and every client that you have a call with, you get excited to talk to them like you're talking to a girlfriend or my guy friends. You know, I have great male friends from, you know, every age, women and men, every age. I have such a diverse client list, cracks me up. My youngest client was a 25-year-old gal that used to be homeless, and now she's one of the top youth speakers across the country, doing amazing. My oldest client hiked Mount Kilimanjaro when she was 89 years old and won the Guinness Book of World Records. Like, you know, sometimes I feel like I don't want to get out of bed. She motivates me, you know? And so even times, so, you know, we have to have clients even motivate us because of what they do. And that's great. So Nicole, it's just such a joy to get to know you. I could talk to you all day. I wish we were hanging out together, just spending the day together, but we got to go on with the rest of our day. So tell my listeners how they can get a hold of you, work with you, get your books, whatever you want to tell them. What's the place for them to start with you?
So first, I'm going to give a free gift, if that's okay with you. So a book, Bankroll Your Brains book, free. It'll walk you through 15 ways to get paid for what you know. Again, it's bankrollyourbrainsbook.com. And then you can follow me in social media. Instagram is my new favorite place, in Roberts Jones. My name is too long, so I'm in Roberts Jones in social media. And then in Facebook, I'm NRJ Enterprises with Nicole Roberts Jones. So those of you that get a book, you know you're going to get an email. You know you're going to be in my database. So if you want more after that, just feel free to email me, and happy to serve you any way I can.
Okay, so I'll say it again, bankrollyourbrilliancebook.com. Go grab it now. We all want that. Nicole, it's been an absolute pleasure having you on my show. And let's stay in touch and do some more fun stuff together.
For sure. Thank you, Debbie. So good to see you. Thank you for having me.
Thank you.